everybody, and welcome to the 19th MCU film, I think it's 19, somewhere around there, of Games My Mom Found. I am Mike Albertin, and who knows a Baba Yaga?
World's greatest grandma, Michael K. Hughes.
And I'm Bill Tucker, and if I have to watch one more of these goddamn MCU movies, I'm going to lose my mind.
Well, whoa. Guess what?
whoa, this is Truth Serum. All that for a Truth Serum joke, you stepped all over it.
I know.
I'm kidding. I'm really enjoying this. That was kind of funny, though. Hello.
I think it's 19th or 20th. I unfortunately did not have that information in front of me.
After 15, I think you just kind of go, who knows? But
it's 20th.
We're here. And we only have like three left after this one. This is we're hitting the finish line on this.
Mm-hmm. That's a wonderful feeling. I mean, it was. I love my idea, but I'm ready to be done with my idea.
It was a long haul, but we have a good one in front of us here. Ant-Man and the Wasp.
2018. It does not feel like 3 years. Well, it's been 3 years the time you're hearing this, so
yeah.
Or close to it. Doesn't feel like that at all.
No, it really doesn't. It's this doesn't feel like that length of time, but you know how time goes in the 2020s? Time has crawled to a stop and has no meaning whatsoever. So here we are. We're in the quantum realm as we navigate this world.
So this is also directed by the same guy who directed the first Ant-Man movie, Peyton Reed. Well, part of the first Ant-Man movie.
Oh, yeah. Edgar Wright. What could have been?
Well, I don't know what could have been. I'm happy what we got, honestly.
Oh, yeah, for sure.
Yeah, who knows what Edgar Wright could have done with the property. This definitely has his fingerprints all over it. It's very much so a sequel in the same style and tone and basically everything else you could ask for in this movie, and I think to good effect. I enjoy this quite a bit. It's a lot of fun.
It's a good standalone movie, but at the same time, it connects enough into the series. But even if you hadn't seen Civil War, you hadn't seen everything, you don't need to. It gives you the pieces you need to know what's going on.
Yeah.
And that makes it a good movie, too.
And I think we talked about the first one, how it followed up
Age of Ultron.
Was it Age of Ultron?
It comes right after Age of Ultron.
I thought it was after some bummer movie, and this was the first one was like a nice lighthearted one, but
it wasn't
this
is the, yeah. Go ahead. Sorry.
This is definitely that with Infinity War after such a bummer of a movie, and then this thing is just the best.
this is like the reprieve we needed from Infinity War, because it took us a month after Infinity War to record this. Like, we did a month break after that just to like, okay, life is okay, we're okay, everything's okay, kind of. And then we move on to the lighthearted fun Ant-Man the Wasp. So they know what they're doing when they release these things. They know people need something fun and, yeah, like we said, like lighthearted.
Yeah, and like Mike said, this one's pretty standalone. It has really little to do, because this happens while Infinity War is going on. And it doesn't really tie into it until the very, very end.
See, there's only 3 days that this is happening, and all you know is that it happened after Civil War.
Uh-huh.
You don't know when it happened. You know it's been 2 years in Civil War, but
right, yeah, because they do make reference a lot of times to 2 years and him getting bigger and that whole thing. So
Captain America.
It's neat to see what happened, and it's neat to see somebody. And we'll talk about this as we kind of go through the beats, but it's kind of neat also to see one of the Avengers or Avenger-esques, because he's not really an Avenger at this point. Because I can't remember what side he was on even in Civil War. He was
on Cap.
On Caps, okay.
That's why he's in prison, or wasn't.
Right, which is why he's under house arrest. So it's interesting, one of them's under house arrest, because he's just a person. Like, good luck getting Captain America under house arrest. Like, you have to put him into, like, a fortified bunker. No, just put a bracelet around his leg, stick him at home, let him play rock.
You remember the end of Civil War, I mean, Cap rescues them. So then he must have, same deal, hey, I want to come back home, so I'll either go house arrest or I ain't coming back. So
basically, yeah. Plus he has his daughter and everything else there to consider. So, but we'll get there. What was your first impressions of it? I loved it. I had a great time.
So Age of Ultron, I've said before, was my favorite MCU movie for a long time, just because I love that movie. But this is the one that knocked it down a peg. Like, I love everything about this movie. It's such a fun movie. It definitely feels like what I think a comic book movie should be.
Sure.
And I'm sure you've got thoughts on this, Bill, but it definitely has the quote-unquote smallest stakes in the entire MCU.
It sure does. Yeah, it sure does.
I mean, the whole thing is just not go to prison. and rescue mom.
Yeah, well.
No, I mean, there is an overarching kind of threat here, but you're right. There's no galactic, you know, threat looming in the cosmos ready to devour the world. Like, it's a small scope with a lot of emotional weight to it. Mm-hmm. And there's lots of emotional weight to this. And there's some stuff in here that's pretty tough to handle. So, and we'll go through it as we go through it. But
The two main villains, I mean, one just wants to kill one person, and the other just wants to sell technology. I mean, they're not even, like, compared to what the MCU villains normally are like.
Yeah,
she doesn't really even want to kill the one person. She just wants to save herself.
Right.
But we'll kill the one person in the process.
Oh, yeah, well.
It doesn't give a shit.
Right, but that's kind of the thing. And we'll talk about the quote-unquote villains, because Ghost, I don't see, is a real villain. She's a victim of circumstance, and again, we'll talk about it. Her story is actually extremely sad. And then you just have mustache twirling war profiteer who's there to make fun of and to, he's there to be defeated, you know, so, which is good. Yeah, he's so one noted and one dimensional, but you know what? As a side villain, that's perfectly fine. Yeah.
He's also, it's just that actor too, though.
Yeah, who gets is that a lot guy? Of parts Again, like we'll, that. We'll get there, but I don't know who that guy is.
I recognize him, but I can't tell you his name or anything.
I can tell you his name, but it's only because of IMDb.
So the movie starts off with a flashback, too, which I like, where you go back to Hank Pym being much younger thanks to technology. What the hell? Also, I just heard a scream in the background.
Me.
So the movie starts off with a flashback. And I like how you have Hank, young Michael Douglas, and they use the technology to make him young. And you have young Michelle Pfeiffer. I enjoy how this kind of sets up where the movie was going, where it talks it gives you all the story that you need to get you right in with the flashback, how Janet was lost, the talk about bringing her back. Everything is just in there right away. Like, this is what, kind of gets you into the movie, what the plot is going to be.
It's a refresher from the first movie, because Hank went over all of this with, I think he went over with Scott, because obviously Hope didn't know. Did he tell her that? I don't know. We've seen this before. Is the point of this.
We've seen it before. I mean, and the director realizes that there may be a few people in this world who are not watching Marvel movies every single year, and there may be somebody out there who doesn't remember what happened in the first one, because it's been a few years. So it's a nice little refresher, like you said, Mike, where just kind of getting us up to speed, right? And it gives us a chance to experience firsthand the emotional beat between mother and daughter. It's not the kind of thing that needs to be explained, but it does come back later on, so you do need that little bit of Jelly Bean and Where She Hides to kind of connect the dots later on in the movie. It's great. It's perfectly fine.
Yeah. Plus, it gives you information that a person wouldn't have had otherwise to make you trust somebody.
Right. Right. Exactly. It's a bit of an exposition, and it's well done. The acting is good. Yeah, it's a perfectly good opener.
The de-aging stuff is still just super impressive. Like, Michelle Pfeiffer doesn't quite look like Catwoman, but Michael Douglas looks like he just stepped out of the game. It's crazy.
Yeah, that movie.
Yeah, no, you're not kidding. It's pretty amazing and also kind of scary. It's like, do we need actors anymore? Just make a robot face and make that happen.
Well, you still need the actor to play the part, then you just DA.
I know.
Or you just CGI their upper lip to make the mustache go away.
I still never seen it. All the times I've seen that movie, I've never noticed the mustache.
Oh, man. I mean, just watch the first scene again. When he's on the cell phone camera, it's super obvious.
Yeah, I noticed it. And I try not to like hone in on that sort of thing. And I was like, what's wrong with your lap?
Hey, go back and listen to our Justice League episode.
Yeah, it's fun. It's actually a good time.
And then it cuts back to, which this movie cuts a lot, but it cuts to Scott with his daughter. I really, really enjoyed this first part when they're in the whole little tunnels. And I just think of Indiana Jones, and I love this. It makes me want to do this. I don't need my son to be wrong. I just want to make my little box fort.
Cassie's, her actress is super adorable in this movie.
Yes.
Oh, yeah.
She steals the scene every time she's on screen.
Oh, yeah. Totally. This guy, as adorable and inventive and cute as this is, just to, in case you're not watching this movie and decide to listen to us for 2 hours and talk this movie. This is he's going through this elaborate cardboard fort where he has an ant made out of, I don't know, cardboard tubes and paper mache. And Luis is controlling him. And he's just got this whole scenario worked out with his daughter as having this like adventure in the house. And you don't realize he's under house arrest until towards the end of this. You just think he's having fun. This made me really happy because it's absolutely adorable. And actually kind of sad because I wish I was this cool as a dad. Like, I wish I could do that. That'd be amazing, but I know I can't. That's
well,
like,
first, you got to be arrested and be at home for a long period of time in order to make that.
I mean, we kind of had our chance last year, so.
Yeah, really. Yeah.
Well, none of us were out of work, though.
Yeah, that's fair.
All three of us kept working during it.
This is true. It's interesting. It's just very funny how, yeah, it's really, no, it's an amazing opening. And again, lets us all know, like an Ant-Man, he's a good guy. That guy there, Paul Rudd, good dude. He's a good guy. He's good. No matter what happens, he's good. And it's great. It's so fun and inventive.
This way this movie just gets you up to speed with everything. You have, you know, when they go down the slide, his foot goes out the fence. And then it doesn't take very long before you get introduced to the FBI. And they kind of talk about, and the way that that Wu, like, it's early on where Wu starts talking to her. He's like, hey, you know, your daddy went to go fight with Captain America. And he didn't sign the Sokovia Accords. And that's why, you know, the whole way that he tries to child-explain it, but at the same time makes it just so complicated.
It's a really clever way to do an exposition dump for the audience. Like, yeah,
it's funny.
Yeah, exactly. It's played for laughs, but it gives the audience exactly what they need to know. It's like, this is how Scott got to where he is now.
Yep. The Zacobia Awards. It's very funny, and the reaction is like, you hang out with kids much? Or, you know, whatever that line was.
You're great with kids. it was fantastic. Yeah, this is
too,
because they're talking about, Cassie says that they were stealing treasure, and he kind of raises his eyebrow. Scott's like, well, you try and entertain a 10-year-old when you're stuck in house arrest.
Right.
And he's like, I even learned up close magic, and he flips the card out.
And
I love that that comes back around.
It's so great. Such a great thing. Yeah.
3 years later.
Yeah. In WandaVision, Jimmy, comes back in that, and he goes to hand someone his card, and he kind of flips it out. Like, it's awesome.
Oh, man, that's cool. I haven't seen WandaVision yet, but no, that sounds funny. Oh, that's great. It's so good how that comes back every 20 minutes or so. That comes back in some way. Super funny. Great recurring joke. It's quick. It's easy to digest. Super fun.
Everyone's so impressed with it. It's like, how'd you do that?
And I was enjoying the song, too, when it has Come On, Get Happy. I can't think of the actual name of the song. I don't think it's that.
I don't remember off the top of my head, but yeah. And then
the Partridge Family theme song.
Oh yeah, there you go. Yeah, and wow. Is this when he has his dream? Yeah.
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 Yep.
That was funny.
Sleep in the tub.
Yeah, exactly. Sorry, sleep in the tub. The Subatomic is so cool and interesting and an awesome idea to have this world of just random colors and lights and figures and shapes. It's a really beautiful, and they always make a mention of how gorgeous it is to be in there, but you're also in the process of losing your mind because we are not meant to be subatomic. And yeah, he has that dream that kind of starts everything in motion.
I do like when he looks in the mirror and he sees Michelle Pfeiffer.
Yeah.
That part's still funny.
Yeah, pretty good.
Great.
Finds himself playing hide and go seek with a little girl hiding in a big closet, as he puts it later.
Yeah.
I wonder if any lions or witches in that wardrobe, huh?
Is that what that is?
That's every time I see a wardrobe, that's what I think of. Every time.
I don't get the reference.
Chronicles of Narnia.
Oh, okay. I've seen one.
And read a lot of books. So it's, and then like, I think it's a great idea how he has a cell phone to call Hank, hidden in a freaking outlet, which again makes sense. I mean, you know, it makes sense that he would have a way to contact them, but he has it hidden because, well, if they found out, you know, he'd be back in jail.
Yeah, because it's something Wu says that if he has any contact with them, then he's in violation of his probation or whatever, and how he hasn't talked to him and since he got back from Germany, because as Cassie puts it, they hate his guts.
I love that she says it, they hate his guts, and just the way she delivers it.
Thanks.
It's so freaking funny.
Pretty good.
She does a great job in this movie.
Yeah, she's awesome. Yeah, everyone's really good as far as acting goes. There's really no dead spots in it.
No.
They have good, you know, everything all well around. It's a very well-round movie.
Yeah. Yep.
And then when he calls him, he just leaves a voicemail because they don't pick up. The thing that I didn't understand, I mean, I know the movie explains it, but I didn't like it personally, is that they're also in trouble for the Sokovia Accords because he used their technology.
Yeah.
So they're on the, I mean, you think they would be like, well, we had nothing to do with it, but, or something. Like, he stole it. Technically, he did.
Yeah, he kind of stole it, but they also were in cahoots. I mean, they had nothing to do with, Sokovia or the Accord or anything that happens in Civil War. But yeah, I mean, they were tangentially involved. They made this suit, you know, using technology that wasn't, you know, approved. And isn't there like Stark stuff in there too? I don't remember exactly.
I don't think so. I think this is not, like the only MCU movie in the entire franchise that doesn't mention Tony Stark's name.
This is true. They don't mention him. Yeah. I don't honestly remember, but
no, he wasn't mentioned in this movie. And it's nice to get away from him for a change.
Yeah. They mentioned Cap quite a bit, but that's about it.
Hey, that's one of the whole Avengers. That's fine.
Better than Black Widow? That's surprising coming from you.
Wow, yeah, good point.
Yes, it is. I love Black Widow, but yes.
All right. So, yeah, after that, so we have... Oh, go ahead, sorry. Yeah, so he calls, leaves the voicemail, and then he... I think it's like 5 minutes later, or pretty soon after.
Yeah, he's sitting down at night, eating cereal, watching TV, and he's getting buzzed by some kind of bug.
What could that be?
He passes out.
Oh man, my wife, she cracks up every time. He just kind of, as he falls over.
All I can think of is you're spilling cereal on the couch. Please don't do that.
His replacement will clean it up.
Fair enough.
I'm sure he did.
His replacement. We'll get there.
Like,
that's
that
funny.
Whole part where he wakes up in the car with her driving, and it's like he's kind of groggy, and he's like, "Oh, where are?" It's like, "Wait a second, what am I doing? I can't be here."
Yeah, is this another dream? And kind of snaps out of it. Wait, I can't be here. She's like,
I mean, I like that because again, everything is on the line. They're not going to care why he left. They're not going to be, well, they kidnapped me. I don't know why I'm here. Like, they're just like, well, you're off to the raft. You go now.
Yeah,
and then and Wu really wants to take him down, and for reasons unknown, but he is really jonesing to just put this guy in behind bars forever. He wants to. So, and I love the reveal early on reveal of the ankle bracelet when his foot goes through the gate, and it's just that reveal is really incredible, and which is why they show up. And now you know why he is so just nervous about leaving. Like, I can't. What am I doing? Of course, they found a replacement. This giant ant is going to wear this thing and just be him.
Yeah. Got 9 hours of sleep, 2 hours in the bathroom, whatever that's about.
Right. I love that scene. And then, like, I don't remember when it is, but there's one point when they cut up the ant and he's playing the drum game. And I think you're playing Rock Band drum game. Come on, yeah. Rock Band. And somebody's like, what are you, 15?
Yeah, that's Hank later on.
I love that.
Really? But Hope says, we got you covered, and it cuts back to the apartment, and it's just the aunt sitting on the couch eating Fruit Loops, and Luis walks in, and he's like, Scotty?
That's so funny.
I don't think we've gotten much Luis just yet. Have we gotten to the point where we realize they have a business that they need to kind of land the big client? Have we gotten
there? Yeah. That's during the little thing with Cassie at the beginning, where he kind of... He's talking out the window. He's like, hey, we need to do this.
Yeah, I just wonder how great he is again in this role. And we'll get to the point, but how happy and wonderful it is that that crew is back doing very little. They don't really do much in this movie, but it's just nice to see them on screen. And they have great, great lines, and their comedy beats are just very, very funny and good.
They are more digestible in this one than I feel they are in the first one.
Yeah, I think so. I think they're cemented as just a crew. They're not really villains at this point anymore. They're not bad guys who are not villains, but they're not like bad guys who steal stuff. They are just starting a business a la Ghostbusters. You know, they're just trying to like just get the business going, which is a very universal theme. Everyone can get on board with that.
You think they took a third mortgage on their house too to pay for it?
I don't know. But yeah, okay. So anyway, I'm just glad to see Luis is back. He's just fun whenever he's on screen, and he's a good time.
Yeah, say that Scott's house is like amazing? I like his house. Like how big? When you like at one point you see how big it is, I'm like, God, that's a huge house.
And then I think they're in San Francisco. They never really quite say, but it's got the deep hills and whatnot. So that house has to be worth a small fortune.
Yeah, the San Francisco, I can't imagine how much that house is worth. It's a little run down, if you notice. Like, again, this is me just being, you know, cranky homeowner. I'm looking at the siding, and I'm like, oof, that siding is looking a little haggard. You can probably have to replace that. So obviously, it's not well kept, but it's definitely a prime piece of real estate, for sure.
And then just when you first see Hank's office, I love how, like, they drive in the van, and when they get to Hank's office, I think she shrinks the car and then puts it away.
They're shrunk to begin with, which you don't really know until Scott Scott tries to open the door. She's like, it won't open while the system's engaged. And then we get our first Jurassic Park reference with the pigeon coming down. The giant eyeball right outside
big
the window.
Eyeball. Yeah. I think that's right. A Jurassic Park reference. That's funny. Yeah, totally.
All the
is.
Shrinking stuff is so funny, though. It's so good in this movie.
Yeah, it's just, again, all this. It's just escalating what happened in the last film, which is kind of what you need to do. And there's just the shrinking, especially in the fights and the battles and the chases. Using the shrinking as a method of evading and attacking is so interesting and good. It's not just the, oh, how fun it is to shrink down and fit into a Matchbox or Hot Wheels box. You know, like, that's fun. When they shrunk the office, I gasped audibly. I went,
yeah, you wouldn't have seen that coming.
No, that it was amazing. So, yeah. All I could think about is as you're, like, walking around this office, you know, in your hand, isn't everything inside just smashing around?
Yes.
I'm like, how is that quantum tunnel staying intact?
Well, they didn't want the scene of them strapping it down and unstrapping things, you
that's
know?
That's fine.
So.
I guess it's a movie. Yeah.
I assume everything's bolted down.
I guess so, right? Everything is should probably be designed to be mobile in your office building.
But the way they throw the office around later on, yeah, no, I agree.
It's just funny.
Everything trash.
I love the design of the lab, though, because you have the giant ants that are doing all their the menial task, but in the background you see, like, giant Duracells that are powering everything.
Yeah.
That's so cool.
Really like certain funny. Things are shrunk down, but certain things are little things mm-hmm. blown up.
It's like so an hilarious. End world hunger with those things.
Yeah, really.
I really got a kick out of the whole Hot Wheels box when he pulls it out, like, before they leave the office.
The Hot Wheels rally case.
Yeah, the little cars in there, and then they just blow up. And I was thinking to myself, you know, he probably stole all those cars, too.
Maybe. I don't know. I mean, they're doing pretty well for themselves. Even Scott's like, hey, if this is where you're living, if you need money, maybe I can help. Hope's like, we're fine. And
we're good.
That's when we get the reveal of the labs. Like, oh, okay, they're doing all right.
I mean, he didn't own a company, but I feel like his asses would have been frozen when they didn't sign the accords.
Yeah.
Again, right. I'm overthinking.
Well, I think they make it clear they lost a bunch. Like, they did not get out of this unscathed financially. So they basically pouring all their resources into getting their mom back or her mom back.
Yeah. And this is when they talk about the whole quantum realm idea, how when they opened up the gate, that's what communicated with Scott and why he had the dream. That's when he tells him, well, it was in a wardrobe or closet. But that that whole thing, it makes them trust him that he has information he would not have or should not have.
Mm-hmm. Right. 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 So-
I think we were down there, you entangled with her. I would never do that, Hank. I respect you too much.
Yeah, that was funny, though.
So they need the MacGuffin, the component, as they refer to it as, just a component.
Yeah, pretty cool. Much MacGuffin.
Yeah, they need the component to finish the thing. Oh, yeah, because they try to turn it on, but it breaks, and they say, oh, we need this component that just happens to fit perfectly in this slot that we designed for it. So they go to meet Sonny. Our mustache-twirling war profiteer villain.
Sonny Birch.
Our evil, evil, evil McEvilson. He is a bad dude.
So he's played by Walton Goggins, and I don't recognize the name at all.
I don't either, but I know I've seen him in a lot of... Like, he's always a villain in everything.
Yeah, he looks familiar. One of those guys that looks like I should know who he is, but I clearly don't. Walton Goggins.
Yeah, I just assume he's a villain in almost everything he plays.
He does a voice in the 2017 Prey game.
Hey, there you go. Please allow me to take this opportunity to tell everyone on this listening to the show, play Prey. Now that it's real free good. On Xbox, you know, or Xbox Live or whatever the heck it is, game now press. You can just play with all the other Bethesda games. There is no reason. Please play that game so they can make another one.
He also was in an episode of The Big Bang Theory, too.
Oh, he was in Django Unchained. Okay, that's where I recognize him from. Is it relatively... He's a kind of a smallish part there, but a memorable one.
He's in the third Major League movie, everyone's favorite.
Oh, that one. That's fine.
He's in a lot of movies. I know I've seen him in different things. I can't figure out like what he was in, but...
Yeah, working actor, just getting it done. So, and it's a pretty big role, right? You're the third part of the villain-good guy triangle, so this is important. He wants, for some reason, he discovers that she's Hope Pym. He had no idea. Clearly, he wasn't able to Google her or realize he didn't do any research on the names she gave him. Like, none. Just
I mean,
okay
you
person.
Think a guy yeah. like that would
yeah, I mean, she,
people.
He didn't do his due diligence, but that's fine. People make mistakes. Realizes she's Hope and decides that, hey, this will be a good opportunity to I guess, put the squeeze on her and, like, demand more?
He says that she's clearly working on something because she needs this component, so he wants to offer her a portion in selling their lab.
That's right.
This is his motivation for the entire movie.
And he's already found a buyer for her lab for $1 billion.
That's also the whole mistake, too, is that he already offered that he's going to sell this to them, and if he doesn't, they're not going to be okay with it.
And he also,
so that's part of the whole thing.
Also mentions he has a contact in the FBI, and that's how you find out about her, which comes back around later on.
It doesn't work out too good for that guy.
No, it certainly does not. No, it does not. It's he wrote some checks he can't cash, and now that he can't cash said checks, he's going to do evil things to make it happen. Do all the stuff to get that technology off to rando buyer.
Of course, she turns him down, so he keeps the component and her money, and well. That's dumb.
It's kind of a silly thing. What do you think she was going to do? Just walk out the door? Okay. Yeah.
Well. I mean, at least you think he'd give her back her money and be like, we got no deal or something. But
no, but he's the evil villain. We got to make sure that he does everything to the utmost evilness, which, again, at this point, it's pretty clear that this is not your guy. Like, this is not the superhero villain that's going to be in this movie. He's just dumbass who's going to get punched in the head at some point or get something thrown on him. He's disposable. So that's why I don't mind the fact that he is so one-noted, because we have interesting coming. And I kind of have felt like if this was the main guy, this would be a problem for this movie. But we have Ghost is going to appear very soon. Wasp has this wonderful now sequence of fighting and shrinking and enlarging and taking out all of Sonny's goons.
It's really good.
All the action in the movie. All the action is so awesome.
Excellent.
I love the giant salt shaker she throws. Oh, and right in front of him, he just runs to the glass and falls. Oh, it's so funny.
It's great. And it's, again, using the environment to your benefit. It's everyday objects becoming major threats, you know, as they're... But he has one of the goons has a meat softener, a meat tenderizer.
Yeah.
And he's like smashing it like you would try to kill an actual bug in your kitchen. Like, come here! And again, everyday objects becoming really dangerous and effective in this. It's so much fun. Until
they do the same bit like they did with the train sequence in the first one, where when it's shrunken down, it's like this high intensity, high octane action sequence. But then it zooms out to normal scale, and it's just like it's just mundane run of the day stuff. So the guy's just smashing the table with the meat tenderizer,
basically.
And the way she fights is great. How she's constantly shrinking, enlarging, like just and just beating the shit out of everybody in that room.
Well, Scott didn't know the tech, so he's also not any kind of trained fighter in the first movie. So it's cool to see someone that knows what they're doing.
Yeah,
and has wings
in combat, and has wings and blasters.
I love that when he's watching. You gave her wings. You gave her blasters. He's like, you didn't have that. I did. I love how he's like, I didn't give it to you.
It's also does a nice job of cementing the lack of trust there is still. They still don't want him really any part of this, but they kind of have to. It's a good beat. And again, it cements that she should be Ant person. She should be Ant woman. So she's the one equipped to do this work, right? Yeah. He's not. But as we see, they really do need each other, which we will find out later. And then after all of this ass kicking is complete, we meet Ghost, who as soon as I saw her, like, she's got some Tali from Mass Effect vibes. Anybody else pick up on that? Like, serious. I was like, whoa, okay. Hello.
Mask in the hood and whatnot. Right.
Yeah. It's just do a little side-by-side maybe if you want to refresh yourself on Mass Effect. But yeah, and so Ghost is very mysterious. She's very threatening. She has the ability to phase through things. Yeah. And that's a cool little fight where where Wasp is soundly defeated.
She also was a B-C lister Iron Man villain before.
So I was going to ask, where does she come from in the canon?
First appearance is Iron Man 219, which I have.
She's definitely one of those characters that I knew nothing about before the movies.
It's also a guy in Marvel in the Iron Man comics.
Yeah, which they kind of pay a tribute to later on when Hank refers to Ghost as a he, because they don't know because their face is covered.
Yeah.
But also in the van, we get the first shot of Chekhov's Altoid tin, which comes back around later on. But Scott's asking for a mint, and Hank's just like, no mints.
And of course, as the audience, we know there's something up with that Altoid tin. They've mentioned it twice already now It's like the filmmakers definitely want you to remember a benign tin of Altoids, which again comes back. Scott joins into the fracas. He gets his suit that's in work, in progress, so half the time it doesn't work. It's a little devicey. You know, it's kind of like convenient where things don't work exactly when he needs them. But it's always to good effect, so I'll kind of like excuse that. That little bit of a plot device where it doesn't work all the time.
I think every time it malfunctions too, it's played for laughs, which is fine.
Which is fine, right. It's always accompanied with a joke or something, so yeah, it's fine.
Yeah, her value of that first appearance is still not very high.
Okay, so hey, if you want to get yourself a first appearance ghost, jump on eBay.
It's a $20 book as of this recording.
Oh, that's nothing. Come on. That's like 18 cups of coffee. Come on.
It was a lot more back when this movie was coming out. Everybody, like, it jumped high, but now it's nothing.
Yeah. So, So Giant Hulk goes appears. So
this is when Scott joins the fight, fight with Ghost.
Yep, and it kind of just doesn't really help much. She ends up grabbing the lab.
Yes. She takes the lab.
After phasing her fist through Hank's throat, which I'm sure feels all kinds of weird.
That was cool.
Very cool.
I mean, from watching enough movies, I mean, I'm assuming when something like that is phasing through your body, it's terrible and you're going to die.
Mm-hmm. Well, yeah, all she has to do is unphase and blah, this turns into an R-rated movie very quickly.
Hey, why didn't she try? I thought you'd pull out someone's heart. You had to go, you had to say a bunch of chanting before you grabbed their heart to pull it out. And how it worked.
No. Temple of Doom?
Yes.
I was getting there. I just couldn't remember which the names of those Indiana Jones movies always mix in my brain, even though I've seen all of them. Yeah.
Too bad. Good thing we only made three of them.
Yeah.
Uh-huh. All right. And then this is when after the lab gets stolen, then you go to the ex-con's office.
Yeah. He's like, we can't go back to my house he's like, let's go back to my house. We're supposed to be there anyway. Who could show up any minute? And Hank's like, that's why we're not going there. And Scott says, what about your house? And everyone just kind of looks at him. It's like, oh, yeah, okay. So, again, we find out that they didn't come unscathed out of this whole Germany thing.
Well, yeah. Plus the fact that they're wanted for treason or, you know, wanted to be arrested, they would seize all your assets at that point.
Yeah. So Scott's like, oh, there is one place we can go. And I love Hank's reaction. No, 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 no.
It is funny seeing their office and you have the whole stupid scene with him in the desk. Like, you got me this desk. Like, he's like, you found this for free. No, we bought it, at a garage sale.
You found this in the garbage. You found this amongst garbage.
you weren't here when we picked out desks. This is so good. It's good to see that group back together. And it's also good to see them just squabbling and arguing while, you know, Hope and Red.
Talking about the Enderman pastries. It's like, what's the favorite pastries?
I was very happy
for breakfast. The oatmeal packets. It's insulting.
I was very happy to see an Entenmann's box that just reminded me of growing up in New Jersey, where we ate so much damn Entenmann's. So that made me very happy. And it's just fun. Yeah. What do you say? Oh, you got the fancy cakes or something like that. The fancy pastry for the big meeting that they're going to have the next day. Just so fun seeing his friends together. I still love T.I. is really good in the role. And the fellow who plays the Russian, assuming Russian guy.
The character's name.
Oh, Kurt, was that right?
Yeah.
Okay.
David Dachshund.
Okay.
Yeah, Kurt. I was thinking
something like that.
I was going to try that.
He brings up the Baba Raja, right? Is that what it is?
Yeah, the Baba Yaga. Which is a dumb joke for one reason, just the whole thing of him being, I don't even know the hell I'm going with this joke. Just the whole point of it being like, because Baba Yaga was some kind of ghost or wherever the hell he comes from.
It's a folktale. It's like
like a boogeyman kind of thing.
Oh, and he's a polka dot man in the upcoming Suicide Squad.
I think we talked about that in the Ant-Man episode.
Sure,
yeah, he's polka dot man.
We'll see. I don't know if I want to see that.
They are fun in this role.
Yeah, no, this is great. Again, they're having a lot of fun. And of course, Hope and Ray are trying to get them on task. Like, hey, we got to like save the mom and get our office building back. They realize that, is this the point where they know they don't have the equipment to get it, but they know someone who might be able to help, right?
Yeah, this is when they mention Foster. He doesn't want to go see Foster.
Yep. Yep, 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 yep. So they go to Foster because they have nothing else. They have no other option to go to Foster. You get
the classic MCU disguise.
Sunglasses. This is my favorite joke in the movie. It might be my favorite. And there's some good ones, but I adore this so much. It's something we've been saying for movie upon movie.
Oh, I 100% stole it from this movie. But
I know, yeah. Did you? Okay, well, that's fine. The fact that it's always... then they just approach the... because they're approaching the college wearing, again, hats and sunglasses. And, of course,
Hank's like, we're in disguise. No one will recognize us.
They were going to a baseball game. It's so freaking funny and on the nose. They meet Lawrence Fishburne. I was very pleased to see him.
He doesn't. Oh, you didn't know he was in this movie then.
No, I had no idea. All of a sudden, I see Morpheus down there talking about quantum physics, and I'm like, huh, that's awesome.
I like this whole lecture. I like his line right before. He's like, I see some of you guys are falling asleep. Well, end is short, because I thought at first he was going to say, and there's Hank Pym in the back, that fugitive. Everybody say hi, or something like that. I was expecting for a second.
Yeah, I had that moment. And again, this is a good opportunity to also explain quantum physics to the audience in a very straightforward way, because we're in a classroom, someone's teaching, and now all of a sudden we're in the classroom and we're learning. That's great. So, yeah. It's good. It's very, very, very good.
So both Michelle Pfeiffer and Lawrence Fishburne crossed over from the DC to Marvel in this movie. Because Michelle Pfeiffer was Catwoman in Batman Returns, and Lawrence Fishburne was Perry White in Man of Steel, I think?
Yes.
Get out of here. Okay.
And they got a foot in both. What's the expression? A foot in both ponds or something?
Yeah, it's exactly.
It does not sound right.
Toe in two swamps.
Got to land this bird.
Yeah. Gotta land this bird. So yeah, so they after the sermon, geez, after the session or the lesson,
lecture,
whatever they call things in college, I don't know.
That's what we're going with now. Sermon.
Sermon. The quantum physics sermon. That's gonna kill you. What do you call things in college? A lesson that you
lecture?
Lecture. Thank you.
Everyone say a prayer to Galileo for the square cube law and why giant ants can't actually exist.
Yes, I do love when they're talking, and because Goliath is a character from the comics, I know who Goliath is. So I didn't know Bill Foster when they call him. Oh, I was Goliath. I when I first saw him, like, oh, that character.
When he talked about getting giant, I'm like, oh, I bet he was Goliath. And he says that he worked with Hank on Project Goliath. I had one of those fanboy. Oh, tap my wife's shoulders. Like, this is a thing. I know that.
I see. I had no clue. I just assumed he had gotten big. And then they're comparing their bigness. Like, how high did you get?
Comparing sizes. What's it?
I love that actress, though, that plays Hope. Like, she's just such a... She just kind of comes off as a badass. And in this line,
they fixed her hair. They fixed her hair in this movie. She doesn't have the stupid bob cut.
You are not a fan of that bob cut. To watch Lost.
I'm not. And they even kind of joke on it later on in this movie.
Her oh, yeah, there is that. There is that joke where she had the bad hair.
Got this hair and I'm all business.
It's a little looser now, so which is good. Him and Hank start arguing. Just again, bringing up the old dislike and disdain. And they leave, but Lawrence Fishburne provides them with one piece of information that'll help. Maybe do a thing with your regulators.
I don't understand why he does that.
I think it's something to do. He understands what they're trying to do. And I think they explain, hey, we're trying to get, you know, mom from the Michelle Pfeiffer. We're trying to get Michelle Pfeiffer out from the quantum realm. Yeah, and he even says later how she's a brilliant scientist. She may be able to help Ghost, right? Like, she's worth saving, because even if you're being selfish, this is in your best interest to do. And, of course, Ghost is not into that idea, but we'll get there later. So I think he just recognizes they're trying to save somebody. They're not trying to, like, just further the science or do something like that. This is an actual rescue mission. Well, so the least I could do is help them get their tech back.
They're after the same thing, too. They're right. Both trying to get Janet out of the void. So,
and at the end of the day, they're both scientists, right? Yeah, they're both, you know, there's always that. It's like, oh, could this actually work? If he's close... maybe I should give him a little bit of a help to get his lab back. Because, you know, and I don't know if he realizes if Ghost has it at this point.
He should. Maybe he doesn't, right? But I don't know. Like, he did, but maybe that's because I just knew where the movie was going.
But anyway, so he gives them the notes on how to do that. You know, now I'm thinking about it. Maybe it was underhanded where he wanted them to get it back so that way they could, like, trap him in there later on. I don't know.
Yeah, it could have been, because that's what happened shortly after this.
Right, so it basically, you also get the Ghost backstory. Or at this point, where are we at here?
Oh, this is when they go in the van and they're discussing the trophy, because they talk about how they need the regulator, But he took the regulators out of the suits.
The new suits don't have them.
But the old suit has it still.
And Scott had told Hank that he destroyed it like Hank had told him to back in the day before this movie. It's like, oh yeah, it totally destroys. And then
my life's work.
It's like, so if we had an old suit, we could do this. You didn't destroy the suit. It was your life work. What was it supposed to do?
So funny. Nice little turnaround humor. You know, it's very good. So he realizes he knows it's in the little trophy.
Oh, yeah, which we did not mention.
Right.
During the Cassie's little thing at the beginning, the treasure they're stealing is the trophy she got for her dad that says World's Greatest Grandma on it. And it's the best.
So cute. So cute. And yes,
the only one there.
Mm-hmm. This is a surprisingly low stakes thing. So they have to go to because she takes it for show and tell. They have to go to her school to take it from her bag. I thought this was going to go someplace, and it really doesn't. This movie
goes someplace, though.
It's just filler.
It's a little fillery because they get in. He's regulator breaks or his suit breaks. So he's at like half size.
I don't even know if I call it a child. Like, yeah, he's like 3 feet tall. Two feet tall or something.
He's the size of like
I love this part, though.
It's so good. I love this whole scene.
I love when he's in the lost and found and he puts on the hoodie and then he's just running with the hoodie on and the teacher's like, stop!
Oh, that guy runs
the other way.
He does. I don't remember where he's from, but he does look familiar.
Another MCU apathetic teacher because he just like gives up immediately. He's like, whatever.
Yeah, he's like, I'm not going to chase after this child. It's fine. And my wife was very funny. She's like, So he escapes. He has the blue sweatshirt on, and he's a little third grader looking guy just trotting away, which is very funny. And the framing of that shot's great too because he is so far away from the teacher. Just this little person you know is an actual adult male just kind of trotting away is very funny and very cute. My wife had a comment. She says, she's like, there is no way a child would escape a school like that. There's no way a kid could just walk out of school in the middle of class. Like, that's not going to happen. So that was a little unrealistic. He was just able to just get out of school and jump into a strange van. And not one teacher says, hey.
Oh, yeah, that part. Yeah, you're right. I was going to say,
we've never seen before. Get out of the van. Yeah, that wasn't going to happen. Excuse me, sir, in the van, could you sign him out? Are you a parent? Can you show some identification? No, none of that. It's okay. We got to get moving going. We got to get going. So
when they're getting the backpack and she's making fun of him, she's like, you can do it. You can do it.
I felt so bad for him. I'm like, you're being needled and teased because you're a little boy.
But it fits her character, though.
It does. It does. No, it's fine.
And it fits the relationship after what everything has happened. You know, she's got some, you know, jives at him. But yeah, I just love little Scott.
They still don't like him. So
no, they don't like him till like the end of this movie, really.
I love that it comes back around towards the beginning when Scott's kind of explaining himself where he went to Germany. He calls Captain America Cap, and she kind of like, Cap? So that's just what we called him. And then in this scene, when he's all shrunken down, she's like, oh, if only Cap could see you now.
Yeah, it's pretty. The needling and teasing is very fun.
And that's probably my favorite callback in Endgame when, well, I'll save that for Endgame.
We'll get there.
That comes back around again. It's awesome.
Another month and a half, probably.
Yeah, well. They get the suit off of the trophy, and the love Scott jumps back in the van. It's like, hey, champ, how was school?
Everyone's giving him
juice boxes with string cheese.
Really? You have those?
I love it. It's so funny. They just ignore him after that. They're just like...
They don't even bother fixing his suit. They just let him sit there 3 feet tall.
They don't like him. I mean, if we said, it really shows. Like, it's something that I didn't really think about, but yeah, they really don't like him.
But they're coming together as this kind of team, right? They're building these relationships slowly and painfully because they don't like him. Yeah. But that's the kind of stuff you would needle a friend about, you know? You just tease somebody. And it's good-hearted. It's not mean. It's just teasing him about the fact that he's walking around like a third grader.
And then they track the lab, which using the device. And this is when you get the whole of them going to Ghost House, which I think was a trap, in my opinion.
Yeah.
Thinking back to it, just how quickly they go in there. Ghost is in her little room that you saw in an earlier scene, doing whatever she's doing, which is helping her stabilize. And then she's sleeping. They do whatever they're doing, and then immediately she's out, which really felt like a trap. Like, she knew they were coming.
I think you're right in hindsight. I didn't see it as that during watching it, but I think you're correct. And that kind of was a trap.
I didn't think it the first time. But now that I knew what Foster's relationship was, I knew where the movie was going. to me, it felt like Foster purposely sent him in a trap to capture them so they could help him help her.
Yeah, I don't think that's wrong.
Are we sure this is our lab? It's not someone else's shrunken building.
I really like Ghost's. Looks like a lighthouse, like a lighthouse lamp.
Oh yeah, it does.
It's basically what that is. It's kind of cool. Just visually, it's very neat. I also, like I said, saw the lighthouse last year, and I'm well versed in what lighthouses look like. So I'm like, yeah, that's a lighthouse lamp. And I don't know why she needs that room to like rephase herself. They don't really explain it.
It's supposed to be helping her with the pain, she says. Okay. And then she says, well, apparently, because apparently it's not working anymore. Yeah.
More of to help, I would say.
I love the effect on her. Like, anytime she's on screen, there are these little echoes of herself kind of floating around her. It reminded me of the end of Scott Pilgrim when Gideon's kind of glitching out. Because they're not always the same. Like, they'll have different expressions on her face or whatever. It's very nice touch.
Yeah, and she's creepy, too. Once she captures them. So she sneaks out, takes care of both of them pretty quickly. They find themselves tied up. Lawrence Fishburne shows up. Basically, he's been taking care of her ever since she was in S.H.I.E.L.D. And we get the big, long, sad backstory.
I like this part. I like how the government trained her to be a killer. And then she essentially turned against them because they were just lying to her the whole time. Like, oh, well, who are you? Just do one more mission. One more mission. Yeah, yeah, we're working on it. And they were never working on it. They couldn't do it.
Was it the government or was it S.H.I.E.L.D.?
It's S.H.I.E.L.D.
It was S.H.I.E.L.D. Because S.H.I.E.L.D. sucks. S.H.I.E.L.D.'s the worst.
S.H.I.E.L.D. would have been Hydra, too, at this point.
Yeah, that's fair.
Interesting. Okay. Well,
Hydra technically takes over S.H.I.E.L.D. pretty damn early.
Because S.H.I.E.L.D. is basically Vault Tech from Fallout. Like, they just suck. Like, they do nothing good. They have no – I feel like it. And it's funny because I always thought, like, S.H.I.E.L.D. was this group of good bros who are just trying to help out. They do everything wrong. They're just sneaky. I mean, maybe they're not building vaults to have people, you know, kill each other in some horrible ways, but
– building weapons out of the Tesseract.
Yeah, really. They're building – they're always about building weapons and defense and blah, blah, blah.
Yeah, they're not very good.
I had big Vault Tech vibes. but anyway, yeah, this is great. And it paints her as an extremely sad character. She
really
in that
feel
month,
for her.
Oh, yeah. Both her parents are dead. Like, my wife even said after, like, she couldn't get a hug from somebody. Like, someone couldn't hug her or give her something. Like, the ability that she's constantly in this phase kind of scenario only because she wanted to try and save her dad from the exploding from their exploding quantum tunnel. It was it's extremely sad. So she paints her as this really sympathetic character who is in survival mode, and that's definitely more palatable than, again, evil person out to destroy the world or gain the world through power or whatever. So it's definitely an interesting character. She's still a little one-noted. I think it's just the nature of this film where it's not trying to explore these crazy themes or anything, but it's very successful in painting her as somebody that you feel for, even though she is the antagonist, you know, working against the protagonist. She's not really a villain.
Did we say her motivation, that she's trying to extract the quantum energy from Janet that she's supposedly been absorbing the 30 years she's been down there?
Yes, that's what this is brought up.
Right, so that's kind of where what she's trying to do is absorb that, so we kind of realign her molecules. Like, she even says she's in constant pain. Like, every minute, her molecules are, like, reconfiguring and ripping apart. And it's sad. It's like, wow, you really feel for this character in a very effective way. Yeah. It's interesting. Really good.
This is when you get the video chat part, which is freaking hilarious.
It's so good. It's 911.
It's texting going off with the duck quacks.
Look, I'm the same way. If my wife calls twice, I know it's a problem. Like, if there's two, then you know, I gotta take this. What's up?
So. It's like, hey, we can't find her shoes for soccer practice tomorrow.
Yeah, which was set up earlier when they were picking Cassie up, and we didn't really talk about Cassie's mom or Paxton, their stepdad. Like, I love that they have such a loving relationship with Scott compared to what he was in the first one, where they'll hug him and then Paxton comes up and just wraps everyone up. It's heartwarming.
Very much so, yeah.
As Cassie's leaving, her mom's like, did you pack your soccer shoes? She's like, yeah, I got them. So then we find out that she's not.
Yeah. That was definitely a callback to when they leave for the weekend or whatever it was. Because, again, he all he has to do is spend 2 more days or 3 more days at home. That's all he's got to do.
That's when everything happens.
And the plot does not let him do that. So,
yes, we
get a lot of great exposition here, and we get that story. And we get to see a lot of it, which is good, too, which really cements that and hammers it home. Really great.
And the whole way they escape is also great, because Michael Douglas, Hank Pym, fakes a heart, like he's having a heart issue or something. They're like, he needs his pills. They're in the Altoids container, the same container you saw earlier where he wouldn't let him open it. And when he goes to open it, it ends up being a trap, and a bunch of ants come out.
Instead of the foam snakes in the peanut jar, it's giant ants in the Altoids.
And this is when they end up taking the lab to the forest?
Yeah.
Okay, they take the lab to the forest, and they set up... I like how it just shows that shot of this random lab in a giant forest. My other question was, how do they have power? But I guess all the Duracell batteries.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah, I can see that.
Oh, that answers the question I have later on, but that's at the end of the movie. We'll get there.
Oh, if we have time, I have many questions about that part, too. Many complaints I want to make as a joke. But okay. This is when you have Lewis meet Sonny. This is funny when Sonny just kind of comes... Because Lewis had called Scott. He's like, hey, I need you to look over this. He's like, okay, I'll tell you where I'm at. And it's just funny that if he wouldn't have said anything, this whole movie would have went completely differently.
Yeah. Well, movie's got a movie.
Yeah, exactly.
God, it is funny when Sonny shows up and tries to be this big villain. He's like, oh, you know, we're going to make you talk. They have, you got the truth serum. It's not truth serum. It makes you highly seductive. Well, it's truth serum. It's not truth serum.
If it walk like duck and quack like duck.
This joke almost goes on too long. Like, it's treading that Thor Ragnarok line where it's very close to one more truth serum too far. It doesn't, though.
Just like Thor Ragnarok never went too far.
Yeah.
Shut up. Not gonna be nice about that one.
No. I know. No, that movie really does. Billy. Know when the bit is over. So
I just everything the truth serum is so freaking funny. And then one part they're like, so where's Scott? Well, you know, I met Scott back in jail, and it's just like, you know, and one guy's like, he's like a diamond in him, you just have to let him know.
So you put the diamond, you got to hear the whole song. It's like, yeah, he's like a human jukebox. And then Louis starts talking about his aunt's restaurant, the jukebox that only plays Morrissey.
That's so good.
Oh, my God.
It's so good. And again, this is the scene where, you know, it's him narrating with other people talking in his voice, which is so, so fun. I love that bit. It's just very clever, very cute. The Morrissey thing is very funny as well. It's just lots of just good stuff in there, for sure.
And I love the talk at the start of this scene where they're talking about we even sprung to clean the van's undercarriage. It's like, oh, why would you waste the money on that? It's a scam. And then Sonny comes in. He's like, yeah, that's only for the snow states. Like, who are you and why do you know so much about undercarriage protocols? And it's just another one of those little throwaway bits that they bring back later for a joke.
Sure do. Everything really does connect up and have a payoff down the line. It's really good at that, for sure.
It's not quite on the level of Spider-Verse, but it's up there.
Yeah, it's pretty funny. Because earlier we didn't mention it, but yeah, they make the where he like they don't have any money, but he got the undercarriage watch. And then and then later on they do make a point like, oh man, it's a pretty dirty undercarriage.
And then while I was under the truth serum, this is where we find out that the ex-con business is going. They're days away from going out of business.
Yep, things are not going great for the business, which again adds a little more stake to it. That's just kind of a hidden background thing. It's not front and center at all, but just another little thing to care about our characters about. At this point, Sonny realizes he's not going to get anything from him.
This is where Scott is figuratively. Where is he literally? Oh, the woods.
Yeah, take this, and like all of a sudden, Ghost just appears. Yeah. He's just been there hiding out. Yeah.
The woods. Baba Yaga. Starts singing the little children's rhyme. Oh man.
Good stuff. Joke comes back again.
Yep.
Every joke in this movie comes back. Like they do a good job of wrapping everything around.
Mm-hmm.
It's this is also the point where Ava suggests her most villainous thing, and this is where Lawrence Fishburne is kind of shows that he's not completely a villain himself. Neither one of these people are. Ava says that in order to bring Scott out, she like, doesn't he have a daughter?
Yeah.
And she goes, so like, I'm just going to grab her daughter. That's what I'm going to do and make him come to us. And Lawrence Fishburne says, basically, no, you can't do that. Like,
so I've supported a lot of things you've done in the past, but this is too far.
That's too far. If you do this, we're done. Like, forget it. You can just disappear into a pile of molecules for all I care.
I like that because I like Foster's character a lot in this.
I do too. I think it's very interesting, and you know, it also shows that there's a little bit of tension there, and that even though Ava's willing to go to any lengths, she has someone at her side to mentor her almost, and say, "Do you know?"
Well, she was trained to.
Well, yeah, and she's been trained to be this ruthless killer. Yeah, she, you know, Lawrence says, "No, can't do it."
And then this is when Sonny realizes that it'd be more work to go after them than it would be just to.
Yeah, it's easier to
FBI.
He says it's easier to steal the lab from the feds than the boogeyman.
Basically. So he calls the FBI.
Yeah, his contact.
Yep. And then Wu, in the midst of his magic trick training, gets the good news. Hey, we got him. We got his location. So they head off. In the meantime, we're now at the point where they open the quantum tunnel, right? I think this is where they actually succeed.
Yes.
Because they put in the actual... They put in the part, the piece that just happens to fit perfectly into the slot that it's designed for. Great.
Yes. And this is when Janet takes over Scott. And you have Hank, Scott, God, what the hell's his name all of a sudden? Scott
Paul
Lang.
Rudd?
Yeah, Paul Rudd, you know, being acting like, you know, he's possessed by someone else. It's funny as hell.
Good stuff.
It's funny and it's sweet. Like, I think the how this is presented is really, really excellent because, yes, it's funny, right? He's now not pretending, but Janet is in him, controlling him. But there is a sweetness because they realize that's Janet in him and they're connecting with Janet through him. So yeah, there's emotional connections where he touches his cheek and calls her Jelly Bean. And it's actually very sweet, yet very funny as well. You know, Paul Rudd is excellent in this scene. He's good through this whole movie. Wow, is he good. This is very good acting. Pretending to be this other person and still connect. You know, it's really, really great.
It's very beautiful.
So she types in the algorithm and they get her location. They have 2 hours to snag her from said location before it'll be another century. Don't know why you put that in there. Another century. Basically saying you'll never have a chance again. This is your shot to get.
And this is when Lewis calls Scott and he warns them and they're like, yeah, they're coming. How do they know? Well, yeah. I might have told, you know, it's just kind of funny.
Yep.
And then this is the same time Wu is rushing to go to their house to, you know, catch Scott because now he knows Scott is not actually there. He's trying to, you know, catch him in the act. And God, the whole part where they show up, they're looking, Cassie's family shows up looking for her shoes. She goes upstairs. She sees the aunt in the bathtub.
It's just that grin she gets in her face. It's awesome.
Yeah. I love how kids react to things. Like, again, if an adult saw that, he'd throw themselves out the window like
but she knows that he's out being Ant-Man and
yep,
she's so proud of her dad.
So good. He's out helping people, as she says multiple times, which is so sweet. Innocent. So good.
And then when they come in, she's like, he's sick. He's really, really sick. And they don't believe
like a lot. And then Wu's like, oh, I've FBI, I've seen worse. Like a lot. It's like this actor, I'm not sure what his name is, but before this, I think everyone just knew him as Asian Jim from one cold open of The Office.
Randall
and
Park.
I feel like this movie, and especially WandaVision, really cemented him as just this phenomenal actor.
Is that who he is? He's the Asian Jim? Oh, my gosh. I know exactly the scene. Oh, that's crazy.
It's
that's
awesome.
Fun. From Office?
From The Office.
Should really watch that show one day.
But it's good.
It's very good.
I cover Big Bang Theory. Man, we'll cover that one now, too, and get out those how many everybody talks about.
Yeah.
God, where were we? I love when Wu does come in.
And he goes upstairs, but Scott gets there in the nick of time and then shrinks down the ants, obviously, because he leaves. Actually, when he leaves, everyone is almost glad he's leaving because they're so mad at him. They're like, fine, just fucking go. We'll get it back to you. We'll get the suit back from you.
I got to take the suit, too.
Yeah. Take the suit. And he gets back in the nick of
time. Or make a comment about the magic trick?
I
know he's watching TV when they tell him to do the magic trick, but I can't remember if they make another comment about it at this point or not.
I don't remember.
Ah, okay.
Answer. Yeah, so we get... So
Hank and Hope get arrested. It goes back to them. And this is when you have the FBI guy who was working for Sonny, who takes the lab and takes it out of the van and puts it in the trunk of his car and gets murdered by Ghost.
You get to see what happens if Ghost stops phasing in someone's chest and he just falls over dead.
Yeah. And the him.
It's cool to see, though. It's cool to see her kill someone. So, you know, she's the villain, but at the same time, you don't care because this person kind of is a villain, too. So you're like, okay, it's fine.
It's a balancing act. Yeah. Okay.
It's cool to see people kill people. It's great.
Well, it's not even that. It's not, I know Mike's coming with this. It's good to see her as a threat, mm-hmm. as a real threat. So even though they've painted her as this victim of just horrible things S.H.I.E.L.D. has done, she's still a serious threat, and she is doing bad things, right?
Mm-hmm. And she's starting to escalate too. Like,
right. She's starting to not care because she's dying and she's in survival mode. So I mean, my wife didn't really like the fact that they paint her as a villain. And my conversation was, well, she's not so much a villain. She's in survival mode. She's an antagonist for sure.
Yeah, sympathetic antagonist for sure.
That's a great way of putting it. Yeah. And you feel for her, and she's doing things the wrong way, but almost to the point where you have to say, can you blame her? Like, this is how she knows to survive. This is how she's been taught. So she's just going to revert to that killing mentality. And it's good. And yes, it is kind of fun to see someone just fall over being phased through. Sorry. It is kind of fun.
Oh, no, I liked it. I was like, okay, good. He got what he deserved, asshole.
Yeah, he was no good to begin with.
I think partly I didn't like, you know, I mean, yes, it's a movie, got a movie. But like the full fact that here you have this character who betrays the FBI, who then betrays Hank and, or not betray Hank and Pym, but turns in Hank and Pym for his own reasons. I'm like, you get what you deserved, asshole, I guess. And this is when you have, like, you have a really touching moment with Scott and Cassie when they're talking about where she, you know, he doesn't want to go back and be Ant-Man. He's like, I want to get out of prison. I want to, you know, be with you. And she's like, well, if you can save people, go save people.
He's like, I've done a lot of stupid things. She's like, it's not stupid to help people or to want to help people.
This is a so really good scene.
Yep. Yeah.
And this is also when they kind of like at Hope and Hank start to finally trust him again, because they're in prison, they're in handcuffs. And like, there's one part, like, we'll be with you in a couple hours. Like, he's like, I forget what he says, something about however long. He's like, and then the guy's like, what, are you going somewhere?
Real quick, at the end of the scene with Cassie, she's like, well, you can do it. You are the world's greatest grandma. It's just another great callback.
excellent. Good. Yeah, she is wonderful in this movie. She's great.
And we probably will be getting, not that actress, but Cassie Lang in the future movies. Yeah.
Endgame Cassie.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I can't remember who the actress was anymore, but
no idea.
Come back to me. But and then this is when Hope gets out of handcuffs, and they're like, how they're about, like, they're going to shrink the wall. And he's like, well, it could fall on us. That whole like little scene when they're trying to figure out how to get out. It
could be load bearing, and they're just going through this whole, like, this is how we're going to get out of here. We're analyzing every situation. And Scott just enlarges the Wasp suit on the table.
He's like, well, how am I going to get out? And you have the FBI costume with the hat and sunglasses.
Oh, yeah.
There's that joke all over again where walks out.
Well, at least he's got a coat on. Like, he's got like a jacket, an official thing to wear. It's not just a hat and sunglasses. But
and
yes,
I think
it's a very
good sense that with there being so many FBI agents, they're not gonna like, oh, hey, that they're not gonna know who's who kind of thing. Like,
yeah, and they could be like, he could be like a transfer from someplace. You know, they don't know who he is. They got other things. They got other birds. So
I buy
to catch.
That better. I do want to make we forgot to mention, but during the lecture, we were making fun of the costumes. How they talk about when they went to Bill Foster's lecture, security had caught them and called the police on them. They had noticed who they were. Right. And it just made me laugh because, like, here we are making fun of the whole fact that sunglasses and hat don't work. They work in, like, Winter Soldier when you're dealing with, you know, special op soldiers, but freaking mall security, you know, security at the campus goes, hey, wait a second. So it's just funny to me.
Pretty good.
It felt like a joke to that whole scene.
Yep.
You know, and they jump in the van and escape. And I think, like, aren't they, like, staring at each other, like, Hope and... Because this is when Hope finally starting to trust Scott again. And it isn't... I think Hank is like, we can go at any time now.
Yeah.
Especially when they start shooting.
It's when they go into Ghost's place for the first time, and Hope's like, oh, if I'd gone with you, you wouldn't have got caught, and like, you should have asked me to go. And then Scott's just kind of staring, and Hank's like, if you're done daydreaming about my daughter, you think you can go get in there? But yeah, this this is more of that, where it's like, hey, we should probably go before they start shooting.
Yeah. Let's get going here, guys. Let's stop with the...
But I like how he's like, I put another tracker on there, and also they look up, you see the ant arrows in the sky.
Ant arrows is kind of dumb. That was the one little bit I wasn't a fan of. It's like, oh, ant arrows. Okay. Was this a video game? Follow the arrow.
Hey, some games don't do that. Some games don't even give you a map. They just expect you to figure out where to go.
Good.
A lot of games that we play anymore.
Sometimes it's good. Just explore. Find it yourself.
It's good like that. Play Legacy of Kain Defiance. Let me know how that goes for you.
It's good in Morrowind where they give you direction. You just have to figure it out. It's not good when it's just like, okay, good luck. Bye.
Well, as I like to say, my beloved Breath of the Wild does it.
Yeah, that's different.
Yeah, because it's amazing.
Beloved Breath of the Wild games. All right, I don't know what you're talking about.
Yeah, I know.
One day that joke will no longer be a joke.
I hope so. One day. Anyway, back to the.
And then this is when you have. I like how you have. Then Lewis ends up joining them. Like, I think he shows up in his van or something, and he does like.
Wasp is so good. I love this joke.
Remember that commercial? What's up? But I can't remember what commercial they're making fun of.
The Budweiser. It's a Bud.
I think it was Budweiser.
Yeah, it's a Bud Light commercial. The Was Up guys. It was probably from the mid '90s. I want to say.
It was somewhere around. I think it was late '90s because it was in the first scary movie.
Okay. Yeah, late 90s makes sense. That's the only era, I think, in history where we'd accept a bunch of dudes going, "Wazza!"
Yeah, that's fair.
In the late 90s, everything was good. There's no problems. Utopia, the late 90s. Yeah, I could see that being a thing then. So, funny joke, though. I had a really good laugh at that.
Yeah, I found it. It's 1999.
Yep.
It's really bad, by the way.
Scott says he told Louise to follow him. So, hey, we might need him.
Yeah, they do.
They do.
And this is when you have. I like how they're just about to activate the quantum, whatever the hell it is. You see little ants taking apart things.
I tell you, ants and swarms are so scary, you know, because they're so powerful.
We live in Texas.
Because we mind this fear very deeply in, I think, the first Ant-Man podcast we recorded.
Oh, yeah, we did. The fire.
Oh, yes. We spent a lot of time on fire ants. And so anytime I see ants just in swarms, my leg begins to itch and be in pain immediately. It's just scary. But it's amazing how powerful they are. Like, ants are incredibly powerful. They are, what is it, they can pull things that are 60 times their weight or something like that. It's pretty cool taking apart. Although I don't know why they just didn't brush them off and plug it back in, but okay, I guess.
I guess they were taking apart other things that we didn't see.
Like, yeah, I'm sure. Again, this is me just being very, very picky and persnickety, but
I've been doing it too. Not a butcher in this movie.
I gotta find something to complain about. I gotta find something to complain about. This movie is so fun and good. So I'm kidding. It's the thing to complain about. But yeah, so they are taking apart their lab. Hank puts on the suit and goes,
because Hank has decided that he's going to die because he needs Hope and Scott to protect the lab.
Right. Yep. So he goes in the big. Oh, go ahead, sorry.
My one wondering about this part that kind of goes against what the movie kind of talked about, the quantum realm. When he goes down there, time should stop moving for them exactly, but time keeps going for them just fine, and for him at the same time.
It just says it works differently down there.
I mean, Endgame. Yeah,
it's wishy-washy.
Yeah, okay. I'll take it. But that's a
good point.
You know, he's having 2001 Space Odyssey vibes down there while they're doing their action scenes up there, up above.
Right, and time's not. Yeah, and they. Because she's been down there 30 years. What is 30 years, right? But compared to the time in the regular, you know, temporal realm. So, and he has a little counter that's typing down how much time he has before, you know, again, how does time work in the quantum realm? That's a good point. I think it's something that's just papered over for convenience and time.
Well, you can also time travel, apparently, in the quantum realm somehow.
Yeah, that's true. You can. You can do that. So, anyway, it's just something that has to be papered over, I guess, for time and for everything.
And this is when you have Ghost fighting Scott. This part is hilarious, where she's fighting him, and then something happens, and they take the lab, and then he's like, have you heard of a...
Misdirection is the first thing they teach you at Online Magic Academy or something like
so
that.
Good. Yeah, there's the joke again. That was so funny. And this is when you have Sonny finally shows up and he's chasing after them, too, to try to get the lab. And I enjoy this lax big action scene in the movie.
This is my favorite car chase in all of cinema. I love this scene. It's so good.
Your favorite car chase in all. So you like this better than Black Panther's car chase?
Yeah, because that one really has like really a couple cool moments when she throws a spear through the windshield from the back of it. Yeah. I would take this over the highway scene in Matrix Reloaded, which is also super good. It also has ghosts that face through things. Yeah, well, no, the rest of the movie is garbage, but...
Gone in 60 Seconds?
Yeah, I mean, it's good. That's good. You get the guy with the wrecking ball being knocked through the wall.
I like Live or Let Die, where they're actually crashing into cars, and the guys behind them, you can't see it paying them off.
Blues Brothers is pretty close, though. They have some good car chases. But I don't know, man. There's like you said at the top of the episode, the whole using the shrinking and growing as an attack. It's there's nothing like this.
Funny. And at one point, he does the whole like villain thing. Oh, call the motorcycles! And also, motorcycle guys to start coming.
Oh yeah. It's like she shrinks down. It's Hope and Louise in the van. And they shrink down, and we get the call back to the undercarriage, where Louise is like, oh, the undercarriage is filthy. And Cope's like, they got bigger things to worry about. And she enlarges the car and basically just jukes them.
That is great. That is excellent. Yeah, I forgot about that. That is a very good thing.
I actually had that happen to me in Cyberpunk. I was playing it, and I went to go get in my car, and another car spawned under my car.
Funny.
It's awesome. That is actually so buggy. Awesome. It's hilarious.
I was going to say, you actually got Cyberpunk to run? Like, actually play it?
It crashed all the time, but it's fun for what it is. It's fine.
Yeah.
Does it work better now?
I haven't played it in a while, I would assume.
Okay. I'm assuming they patched out most issues by now.
Who knows what disaster that game is. How funny. That's cool. I'm glad you got it to run and actually play it. Sometimes bugs are fun. Sometimes bugs are really, really... Glitches can be lots and lots of fun.
And you get that famous curvy road from San Francisco.
Yeah, mm-hmm. Very nice.
Lombard.
Is it Lombard Street?
Yeah, that's what the picture says that I'm looking at.
Yeah, Lombard Street. Yeah,
I like how that's in here.
It's very unnerving to drive down. I'll be honest with you. You go 2 miles an hour, and it's the curvy Lombard Street. Everyone drives down it when you go to San Francisco.
But why is it even there?
I don't know. Just because it's there. It's a curvy street.
I think it's an aesthetic thing.
I was wondering, you think at some point I know right now it's a cultural thing at this point. Like, it's a landmark, but you think they just, cut it down and make it one road.
Yeah. I know it from Driver San Francisco.
Good game.
It is a good game. But okay. I like it in this movie where they're teeny tiny and they're outrunning this brick avalanche.
Again, very funny. Again, recontextualizing everyday things to be major threats. It gets so interesting. And you get good.
Our Stan Lee cameo where they shrink his car by accident. He's like, man, the 70s really were something about the 70s or the 60s.
Yeah, it's like the 60s were fun, but I'm paying for it now.
Yeah, that was funny.
And before that, Hope shoots a disc at one of the motorcycle guys and just shrinks his bike as he's riding it. That's got to be the most awkward thing.
Surreal experience of that man's life.
And then the Pez dispenser joke, because earlier he mentioned how you want a Pez? And then he throws the Hello Kitty Pez and they enlarge it.
Oh, and I read that one coming. I'm like, okay, when is that Pez going to explode into something giant and break something? Just wait. Waiting for that one. And sure enough, they pay it off.
Pezzed.
They can't bring up anything without it paying off in this movie, which is really good. Every little thing leads to something else down the line.
No,
but you just kind of pointed out how that is a hindrance too, because at that point you're expecting it when they show something off. It's like, okay, when's this gonna pay off now?
Yeah, I mean, then you have like the scenes where the lab keeps getting stolen by all the villains and being tossed around, and Hank is still somewhere in the quantum realm during this whole time. But there's one part where they tell, I think, either something about Lewis crashes the van and they tell him to open the Hot Wheel container and pick out his car.
I love you, Dr. Pam.
That was funny. It just reminded me of the Cars movie. So it just did to me, but that's
good. Cars? Like the...
Yeah, in the Cars movie, there's when they're on the highway, they go with some cars that are like supposed to be like souped up sports cars, and they all have Hispanic accents. Yeah. So that's what it reminded me of.
Oh, well, yeah. It's Fast and the Furious at that point.
Yeah.
Oh, jeez. Yeah.
And I really like the sports car. And I feel like when he jumps off the ramp at one, or off the highway, and he's like, or not off highway, off the street, and he goes up in the air and the other car goes behind him, all I could think of was Ferris Bueller's Day Off, and I felt like a reference to that. Maybe it wasn't, it's just a thing, but that's what my brain went to.
I didn't see that. Man, that bumper, that actual size car, though, it clips the back of his. He's super close.
Yeah, sure does. Also, Hyundai must have spent some money on car replacement because they are prominently displayed in this film multiple times.
Oh, yeah.
Lots of different cars in this movie, but Hyundai for sure in some standout areas. So there's your product placement of the day. Hyundai just ran the check. So good for them.
And the Duracell batteries.
Duracell, too. Yeah, exactly. Duracell, too. Could have been an Energizer, but no.
And you have Sonny get on the boat. And this part is funny because Scott is all enlarged. You know, he's been enlarged, a giant man. He's trying to get Sonny. He's like, how do you get on that boat so fast? And I laughed. I'm like, you're right. He shouldn't have been on that boat
How do you even have time to buy a ticket?
Very funny. And again,
like on the movies, making fun of itself.
Yeah, mm-hmm. This is definitely a self-referential. Like, we're going to hand wave this because we're a movie. So let's let one of our actors kind of... And they do this a couple times. The baseball hat, that was another thing. Very fun moment for sure.
And you get the Ant-Man whale.
Yeah, it's the guy just talking about it. It's like, oh, the whales come in here to breed. They're down there doing the nasty. And my wife's like, rewind that. Did he just say that?
Sure enough. Basically, that's it.
It's funny. Did he ask you what he said?
Yeah, yeah. I think it's why Senny's talking on the phone. You can hear him in the background.
Yep. Wow. Okay. That's funny, though. I didn't catch that when I was watching it. Okay, I even had subtitles on, but yeah, I didn't see that. That's kind of funny. And then the whole thing with him being the whale is just funny how he pops out of the water. Like, he does the feet thing and looks like a whale. And just
got a breach.
What the hell? What is going on? Meanwhile, we have Hank, who's descending into the depths of the quantum realm. Get to kind of cut back and forth between him going into deeper and deeper, following the signal. I love the idea he's just shrinking and shrinking and shrinking. For some reason, the vehicle breaks, and I'm not sure if this is the point where or somewhere around here. With those giant grub-looking things.
The water bears? Yeah, those things are terrifying.
Oh, my God. No. Those, no, 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 no. Please stop. Please go away. Yeah, like that's giant nightmare fleas. Box. They're like giant grubs. They're like these just... Luckily, he was able to get out in time. And I don't remember where he... At the point where he actually lands.
Somewhere very deep in there. I mean, it bounces around.
It's around this point. It's around this point. Oh, because this is when Sonny's on the boat. Ant-Man will, yeah, and then Ant-Man will, he basically snags the office building.
I think he grows even bigger than he's ever been.
Yeah.
Because he is gigantic here.
Yeah, he's bigger than he was in Civil War, I think.
Mm-hmm. Oh, I didn't know these things, giant flea things are real.
Oh, yeah, those are actual things.
Oh, God, you sent a picture. Do I have to look at this?
It's the Wikipedia. They're horrifying.
That's not great.
It makes it a lot worse when you find out they're actually, I didn't know they were real.
Yeah, but they're like basically dust mites. They're
I know they're
beyond microscopic. So
I mean, I'm not planning on shrinking down that small anytime soon. You know?
No. Okay. Well, no trips to the quantum realm for you.
No. I don't need to see giant bugs.
Tardigrades.
I live in the north for a reason. We don't have giant bugs. I stay away from the south.
I'm gonna say this wrong, but tardigrades, known colloquially as water bearers or moss piglets. Ew! Like even the nicknames are horrifyingly disgusting. Oh no. Moss piglets. Yeah. Cool.
And this is when you have Hank hallucinating and he ends up seeing and Janet finds him down there. Ends up doing something like
He's back in their old house and he sees Hope and he sees Scott and then he sees a silhouette you're supposed to think is Ghost. And then as he gets closer you find out it's Janet kind of like savaged up as she's been down here for so long.
Savaged up.
It's kind of accurate.
Does a little mind meld thing on him and gets his molecules realigned and they have a loving embrace. Very sweet. And then it's time for them to get out of there. They can't go anywhere because it's still shrunk down. The office is still shrunk.
Yeah.
But not for long because somehow, some way, I forget who does the – who
Ghost.
Increases.
Ghost does it. Because Luis has had the remote this whole time and she corners him and takes the remote and just – Scott had got the lab from Birch, which is funny because he's like giant, so he's holding them up in the air. He's like, you're just embarrassing yourself. Let go. Embarrassing yourself. And then he passes out because he's too big, and the lab just kind of goes across the dock, and that's when Ghost enlarges it.
And I like the how Scott getting big makes him extremely tired, which makes sense. Like, it's got to be exhausting on your system to support a heart that is now like 14 feet long.
The air feels chunky.
Yeah.
And another great line.
Yeah, and it alludes to it much earlier when he's talking about being big. Mm-hmm. Oh, that's right. He's talking Lawrence Fishburne about it. He's like, I slept for 3 days after doing that. So it's a very good callback.
Does anyone have any orange slices?
And I like the whole thing, how Hope saves him, how Hope jumps in there, gets him out of the water, and then that was a good scene, I thought, too.
Mm-hmm. And it's a really cool detail when she shrinks him down. There's that big displacement of water. So she's like spinning and it kicks up all the dirt. Like, I thought it was a cool touch.
Very cool touch. Because where'd he go? Yeah. Yeah.
That makes sense, though. Oh, it's just a really touching scene. The way that, you know, you kind of see her, you know, caring for him again. Like the trust has been rebuilt, especially after he goes and saves them from prison. Mm-hmm. When he didn't have to.
Is this when they have the big smooch?
Yes, because he kind of snaps out of it, and she plants one on him.
So, Bill, what did you?
Yeah, I know. I was going to be asked about it, because I am now the authority on movie romance. So let me weigh in on this. It's fine. It's earned enough. It's fine.
They had a pre-established relationship, so yeah. I mean,
they've gone through a lot together. They
didn't just fall on her car and she was like, "Oh, hot guy." Nothing like that. Oh, God.
I knew there was a Thor joke.
It always comes back.
There always a Thor joke.
Thor, like the Thor joke just knocked on the door like, "Hey," I'm like, "I know, 2 seconds, I know, you're coming in, it's fine."
Though when Birch got on the ferry, I think we missed a low ball for the Incredible Hulk joke, like, oh, how did you travel that
we
fast?
We really did. And actually at this point too, because he actually gets back home, right?
Not yet.
Okay.
But yes, that's coming up. This is where you have the idiots tase the goons. Yeah. I just call them the idiots, the X-Con guys.
Tase the goons.
that's how I wrote my notes, because that's what it was. I mean, they just tased the guys because they were about to, like, shoot Louise or something. I don't remember. Yeah. This is when you also have Ghost starts extracting the essence or whatever the hell, the quantum stuff from Janet, as Janet is trying to come out of the quantum realm.
Mm-hmm.
And that whole time. And
yeah. A lot of this science isn't well explained. I understood what was happening. She was trying to steal essence juice from Janet. And the way she starts reacting to it in this little Pym ship, was really scary. Like, you can see she's kind of like, her molecules are doing what she would do. But of course, they come in last minute, save the day. They turn off the dumb thing. And
so as they come out of the quantum realm, Scott knocks Hope out of the way of the ship, and it crashes into Ghost. And I look at my wife. I go, "She got subdued." She's like,
"Wow!"
How did your wife look at you?
Oh, she rolled her eyes big time.
Ding, ding, ding! Winner, winner, chicken dinner. That is awesome.
Wow. Yeah, that was funny.
Very good.
And then I think then they pull a plug or something and to stop Ghost from doing it too, I think, to turn it off. I can't remember exactly, or maybe that was right before this happened.
I think they just start fighting her right before.
Okay. And this is when Hope and Janet get reunited. And I'm thinking to myself, Ghost is out for a little bit of time during this point after they hit her after she got subdued. And you think that, like, one, think she could have phased out, but I guess because she's absorbing the essence so she can. I'm okay with that. But she was out for a little bit. Because they had time to hug and say, "Oh, so good to see you, Mom," and stuff like that.
Yeah, and Hank's like, "Oh, don't worry about me."
It's like, you idiot. Yeah. You've been around for 30. You weren't gone for 30 years.
Yeah, man, that's crazy to be gone for 30 years and just your daughter looks like a completely different person because she's not 8 or whatever
she's
anymore.
Not, yeah, she's not 10. Yeah, no, it's imagine the, again, you figure Hope's probably in her mid-30s, you would think. So it was 30 years. You're probably, you know, 7 or 8, maybe. When she left, yeah, imagine that, right? Just the shell shock. She takes it rather well.
Yeah.
She's kind of like, "Oh, okay, here I am." But again, yeah, we don't have time for this. We're at our last 20 minutes of the movie. So
I like how the fact that Janet was, like, able to heal Ghost, and that was the whole problem all this time, and she's able to help her, and she's not in pain anymore. Like, I thought that was, like, really cool.
If you'd gone about this the right way, it would have worked out for you.
Yeah.
Right. If you had gone about this the right way, it might have worked out sooner, and which is a really good and interesting kind of just thought. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And I like when they have, and then you have the final part with the goons where they gain the truth. The cops show up and they gain the truth serum. They're like, "We did it. We're murderers. And we've
killed
this,
so many people. So also my restaurants have several health violations. Some of them would shock you."
And the guy's like, "It is truth serum."
Callback.
Great callback. My favorite little callbacks in a movie, hence my open.
During this part, when he became Giant Man, he was on TV, and Wu was rushing to get down there, and took Wu a while to get down there. So Wu finally gets down there. He sees a giant suit. He's like, "I got you, Scott. It's up. Just give it up." And here's my, I mean, I didn't think about it during this point, but now I'm going to make jokes about it, where the suit ends up shrinking. At the same time, Scott is running there, half naked, just wearing his boxer shorts, running home, and somehow he's able to get home before they jump in their cars and rush to his house.
Well, we see Hope pick up the suit, so I just kind of assumed that she gave him the suit back, and then
he planted it. Put his hand out and see if someone gave him a ride home, you know, the thumb up. You know? Okay.
There it is. There it is.
I was waiting for it.
Check off your bingo card.
I was waiting to make that joke for a while, though.
Yeah.
And I love how when they get into his house, though, he's just sitting there playing Rock Band. Like, "Oh, hey, guys, what's up?"
Yeah. And we see Ghost and Foster kind of on the run, and Ghost like, I've done terrible things, you haven't, but Bill's he's got feelings for, well, not feelings, you know what I mean, father daughter thing. He's got an emotional attachment to her. He's like, "No, we're doing this together."
which is it's powerful, and I think it's another good scene.
Mm-hmm.
Again, she's a villain, but she's a villain that you care about. Like, I'm assuming she's either going to be in Quantumania or she'll be somewhere down the road at some point.
Yeah, because they mention her in the Stinger, but we haven't seen anything of these two in the well, I guess the only four movies we've had, three movies we've had since this one.
Yeah, and one was called Iron Man Far From Home, so.
Yeah, well. Okay, there.
And then you have, I love how Scott then finally, he's, you know, like they come there, they take off his, you know, his thing, and Wu's like, well, I'll see you, I'll get you next time.
Like, it's like, I'll see you later. It's like, what do you mean? I thought maybe you want to go to dinner or something. It's like, do you want to go to dinner? No.
Very, yeah, nice little moment. Yeah.
It's a funny scene. And then when he finally goes to Cassie's house and he's able to leave, and he, I mean, that was just really great. Powerful too.
And just another big group hug.
Awesome. Great. He's showing up at their door as opposed to them at his. It's
And then
so,
XCOM is famous now because of they brought down Sonny Birch.
Yep. So now they want to, everyone's clamoring for their services, which is great.
And they seal the big deal that they've been alluding to this whole movie.
That's it. Excellent. Good, good, good. It would have been terrible if they hadn't. So yay for that.
I love that scene where it's still got Scott at the tiny table.
And then you have the scene that and Mike was referencing earlier that I had issues with too, where Pym then puts a house on the beach.
Yeah. He puts I don't know if it's their house, but it's this old Victorian looking house, and they've been large it. House. That house has no plumbing, no electricity.
I thought the same thing. No foundation.
That is a beach. A beach is not like it's going to crumble right into the freaking sand.
Well, maybe they got like Barbie's dream house, like that Hot Wheels rally case. They got a whole case full of little houses. It's like, oh, and this one goes. So let's make a new one.
they have a whole city.
Just went around stealing people's houses. Shrinker house. All right. We'll take this with us.
Oh, it's fine. They got a bunch of giant Duracell batteries packing, powering the whole thing. It's fine. Don't worry about
it. That could work.
No,
it's still no plumbing.
Like I said, I'm like, it's built on sand. Didn't you guys read the Bible? You're not supposed to build things on sand. You build things on rock. I know Jesus said that at some point. So I was like, it's just, I had the exact same thought. Like, where's the foundation?
Here's our nice house. I'm going to go dig the outhouse out back.
That's it. Yeah. Hon, are you sure this thing is level? Because you just kind of threw it on the grass. So maybe at the shrink.
Maybe we should put down some concrete first, you know?
Yeah, like a little bit of concrete.
You couldn't shrink some concrete? Go, zoom. Okay, I got a concrete block right here. All right, we're good.
It's cute for what this
movie is. Oh, yeah, it's an absolutely cute moment, but it raises lots of questions.
I really did. I had lots of questions. Yeah, exactly.
I just thought it was funny, because, I mean, something when I first saw this movie I didn't think about at this point. Now that we're all homeowners, I'm like, here.
Are you sure? Yeah. I mean, I love the fact you put it remote, so there's no HOA or anything, but I mean, what school district is that in? Like, well, I guess you're old enough, you don't have to worry about that. So anyway,
we're not gonna have the neighbors coming over, we're like, hey, your aunts are kind of dutying on our line.
yep.
And then you have a really good final scene of the actual movie.
This is my favorite. I think it's you.
It's Hope, Scott, and Cassie are sitting in a car watching a movie, and they're watching them, the ant movie.
Oh, this
from
never mind. I was talking about this. Go ahead. Sorry.
What were we talking about?
No. Go ahead. I'm sorry. I was talking about the next scene coming up. Okay, this is very good, though. My wife panicked, but go ahead and explain.
Well, yeah, it's made to look like they're at a drive-in because they're sitting in a car watching the movie with other cars around them. You can kind of see in the background. And Cassie's like, well, I want to help people too, but my dad wants you as a partner. And then we get the moth land on the movie screen, and only to pan out and find out that everyone's shrunken down, and they're other Hot Wheels cars, and they're watching the movie on the laptop.
Yeah.
And oh my God, this moth is terrifying.
No, here it is. My wife is deadly afraid of moths and butterflies. I don't like them either. I prefer butterflies didn't exist because they flit. They kind of just flit. They don't fly. They just kind of like just flap their ugly wings and just like they're big and they're gross. My wife literally went, okay, no. Okay. Like she had a moment of terror. Not good, these moths. I'll tell you a very quick story. I was in Niagara Falls on the American side, and there's a butterfly conservatory. And I don't like butterflies, as I said, but the people I were with, they want to go. So I walk into the butterfly conservatory and I start panicking, like dang near a panic attack. Get me out. I got to get out. I get out. I just get through the thing conservatory. I go out the other side into the gift shop. I'm taking my breath, and all of a sudden, this guy in a giant butterfly costume just starts walking by like, and I have never wanted to punch someone so hard in my life. My first thought was almost murderous, like, oh, fuck you. These are not fun. This is you. No, I don't like you either. So I don't like butterflies or moths, and this was a very scary moment. So, yeah, terrifying.
Okay. That's not something I expect this to go, but all right.
Man, it lands on that car, and that car shakes. That thing is...
Oh, no. Please stop talking about it. Yeah. Oh, and the movie they're watching, did anyone get the reference of what they're watching?
Yeah, them. Mike pointed out it's them.
Oh, you did? Okay, I'm sorry. I was still cringing in my brain about moths. So. Yeah,
it them. Is cool very that fun. It's the old ant movie.
Yep, very good.
I love the good. Fallout 3 mission that calls back to that. I think it's called They, but it's the fire-breathing ants.
Yep.
That is a good game. We need to cover that one day.
Yeah, we've talked about it. It's going to be a tough one to work in somewhere.
It's not that long.
It's big enough.
We could do it.
Anyway.
All right. That's neither here nor there.
New Vegas. I just finished it. Do New Vegas. I finished one of the DLCs. I started a second one, and I said, nope, I'm done. I'm just tired of this.
Yeah, they have to do it sometimes. One day. Then you have credits, and this is when you get the first scene, which is... of the Pym family, and then they're having Scott go down to the quantum realm to get quantum particles to help Ghost. And when he's in there, he's like, all right, I'm ready to go back, guys. And then they all turn to dust, which is, because Infinity War happened.
Mm-hmm.
This is my favorite end credit scene in the MCU. I've never seen it before. My wife and I, our jaws hit the floor for a good 30 seconds. Because it's so well timed, the pacing of it's great, the payoff is great. It has ultimate impact. Like, it's not just showing Thanos' dumb face or or joke, which are fine for end credit scenes because you get our joke one at the very, very end. But this has so much weight and impact, almost like the Captain Marvel one, where not the end of Captain Marvel, the one where
Infinity War.
Thank you. Which also has a lot of impact and meaning. This one. It sets off the events of Endgame. Like, this links up directly, I believe, to the beginning of Endgame.
Yes.
So it is, just extraordinary. And now I know why he was in the quantum realm and stuck there. Oh boy. And they put it right after they know what they were doing. They put that right after the credits. So.
Wow. And then you get your final credit scene, which is an ant playing Rock Band. But there's something I didn't notice during the scene that's kind of foreboding, is the TV goes blank. Like, you just see the color screen where they don't have a signal anymore because everyone just disappeared. The world is, going into dystopia all of a sudden. And it's just, it didn't hit me. I'm like, oh, wait a second. The TV's all blank. Yeah. You see that scene. I'm just like, oh, it happened. And so the ants, just no one's there for the ants. He's just playing Rock Band. It's not as happy as a scene as it once was to me when I caught that TV part.
It was clever and cute, and I'll let you chime in, Michael, on these, but it was clever and cute, but you're right. It had a bit of sadness, and I thought, oh, no, this ant is going to live this mundane life for the rest of its sad existence. Like, that's all this ant's going to ever do is – which I guess could be worse, but hanging out in bathtubs and playing Rock Band. But you're right. No, it has a bit of weight to it, but it is very funny to see the ant still doing his routine.
The question I had is, when they're going into the quantum realm to get the healing particles for Ghost, I asked my wife, I'm like, what happens to her over these 5 years? Like, if she didn't get dusted, she's pretty much just done for.
That's a very good point. Yeah. That's a very good point.
Hopefully they'll bring that up in the next Ant-Man movie. At least something.
Yeah. Something.
That's a good point. Hmm. Yeah.
Yeah. The ant one, I didn't even bother to watch last night when we were watching. I'm like, we don't need to see the ant watch him playing Rock Band, whatever. The ant playing Rock Band, we didn't bother.
Oh, you didn't bother.
Yeah, you don't need to. Yeah. All right, and that brings us to shelf, stack, or box. And I'll go first. This is going on the shelf. This is a really good movie. It's still funny. I want to say I like the first Ant-Man better, but I can't really remember if I'm remembering correctly that I like the other movie, or I just, I don't really know because I've watched so many MCU movies in a row. Don't do that, by the way. But still, it's a really good film. The jokes land. I enjoyed it. I haven't seen it since theaters, and I'll watch it again for sure. It's a really good movie going on the shelf, and I'm glad we watched it. How about you, Hughes?
It's going to go in the box. Like, I hate this. No, this is my favorite MCU movie. I love this thing. It's such a fun, self-contained story other than the references to Civil War and the first Ant-Man. But like you said, the jokes all land. The comedy is well done in this one. Like, I don't think there's a single one that I just like, whatever. Like, I was laughing the whole movie. It's great. And the action is... among the best in the MCU, which I know is going to get some gasp out of people because the MCU is known for its action, but there's nothing like it in this. Like the action in this movie isn't like the action in any other movie with the shrinking and the whatnot. So yeah, it's good. I can't even put it into words, apparently.
No, you put it into words. You did a very nice job. Don't sit on it.
All right. How about you, Bill?
I can't say this is my favorite MCU movie. I think that's still, well, we're gonna actually do our rankings at the end of this thing.
After
right?
we All finish right. Spider-Man well, Far From Home. We're doing another episode where we think back about this crazy idea somebody had.
Ah, yes. We'll reminisce. I think this is a excellent movie. I think it's better than the first one. Mostly on the strength of the amount of shrinking action there is. I know that sounds kind of basic, but like Michael said, it's so fun. Like and it's extremely unique. There's nothing like it in the MCU. And I think the villains are better. Sorry, villains. The antagonists are better. they're just better than whatever his name was from the first one. Yellow Jacket. Yeah. Right. I think the antagonists are better. I think there's a little more emotional weight. There's a little more stakes. But again, it's aim small, miss small. It's a really delightful movie. So this is definitely on the shelf. And this is easy. And I think I put Ant-Man on the shelf as well. I almost like to see this as like a part one, part two kind of thing, but I definitely would rank this higher than the original for sure. And it's delightful. I'm so glad I spent last night watching it. This is a lot of fun.
It's nice to have such low stakes for a change, especially after something like Infinity War. This was exactly what I wanted.
Right, because we have galactic stakes coming up in Endgame. And again, I have
Marvel, I think, is galactic states too, if I remember.
Yeah, there is. Well, yeah, that's when we get to the Skrull, right?
Yeah.
And they're always big stakes, evidently. So, yeah, I'm just glad we saw it. I'm glad I got a chance to finally catch it because I missed it first time around. And I'm bummed I didn't. Should not have.
I'm surprised. But I guess, life was probably happening, I'm assuming.
Yeah, kid, and that whole thing. Yeah. Get in the way.
Oh, and Mike, you'll like this. On IMDb, this movie actually rates under Spider-Man Far From Home.
That's okay. Not everyone can have the right opinion.
That's people, those things are influenced by a number of things. And by the way, Michael, I'm just going to say real quick, because I think some people on our audience might be banging their head against the steering wheel when you're talking about car chases and the great car chases. This is not better than Steve McQueen in The Great Escape.
Yeah, I have not seen The Great Escape, and I know that's one that people always reference, but...
Yeah, I'm just saying, because it's low-hanging fruit. Our audience may be like, really? Mm-hmm.
Isn't
it better than The Great Escape?
What movie is that with the car chase that's by Edgar Wright? Drive or Baby Driver?
Baby Driver.
Oh, I have not seen that either.
I haven't either.
Or Baby The French Driver's Connection.
So good.
Oh. French Connection is another one that I always see.
French Connection to people, I think, is slightly overrated, but we'll talk about 1970s gritty cop movies maybe another day. But
seen it.
It's good. It's a good car chase, French Connection. I just like those because they're real cars driven by real people. And the actors themselves, like Steve McQueen, that was his motorcycle. He was doing all that crazy stuff because he was a maniac and a wild man.
Never seen that movie either.
Steve McQueen's the man.
Bullet is another one.
Oh, yeah, Bullet. Yeah.
Oh, yeah.
Anyway, okay. None of them are like, this one's unique, so it's got that.
None of them are shrinking and then, like you said, like expanding to pop another car into the air and flip them. There's none of that. No,
that would be very strange. We also didn't talk about giant Ant-Man using a flatbed truck as a makeshift scooter.
Skateboard as like a skateboard. So good.
Okay, that was funny too. Gosh, that was good. All right, and I should introduce what we're going to be talking about next time we come to you with another MCU episode. We are covering Captain Marvel.
Very, very, very divisive movie.
Like, is it? Is it a divisive
movie? Oh, it is. Yeah.
I remember really loving it when I saw it, but again.
But you, it seems like you either love it or hate it, so I guess we'll talk about that next time.
Indeed.
All right, and we will see you guys all. What the hell am I doing? I need to plug. What the hell am I doing? God. Bill, where can people find you? Because your show is live.
It is. This is going to be released like in June, I'm suspecting, right?
Something like that.
Yeah. That doesn't matter. It'll be live. Yes, A Gamer Looks at 40 is finally in your ear holes. If not, it should be. Very quickly, quick plug. If you've listened to the show and listened to the series, you've heard before. But it's a retrospective on the history of games as told through the stories and recollections of people who have lived it. Our own Michael Hughes is going to be on there. We're going to be recording his this week. We're going to talk a bit about the NES era and arcades and fun stuff. Our own Mike Albertin will be on later because he's a young blood and he grew up in the Super Nintendo era. So that'll be a coming. And yeah, it's going to be a pretty neat series. So be sure to check it out. A Gamer Looks at 40 on Twitter, because I can only handle one social media thing mentally and time wise. So that's your option.
Nah, you're good. You don't need to do them all.
I really don't know.
Trust me. I know. I speak from experience.
You have them all. I don't know how you do it.
Not TikTok, though. We should be on TikTok, but we are not.
Oh, good
TikTok.
Lord.
Oh, boy.
Yeah. No, people have told me I should. And I'm starting to cut out clips from our show when I edit.
Okay.
Like the salmon one. So, but yeah, I haven't put us on TikTok yet. But all right. And if you enjoyed this episode, please go check out all our other MCU movies. We have covered everything up to this point. So almost everything is out there for you. Go listen to those. We cover games. We cover comics. We do other movies too. So definitely go check all those out. And games are our bread and butter. We do games every week. And if you our intro and outro is courtesy of Bobby, a.k.a. Mike Stoney from ZP Bite the Bullet, Song and School Kids Squad. You will see a link in the show notes for his channel. You will see a link in the show notes for Bill's podcast, A Gamer Looks at 40. There should be, I'm assuming at this point. Yep. So definitely check those out. And we have a Patreon. Finally, I did set one up. I forget to mention it here and there. But if you want to throw us a dollar, we don't have any incentives current at the moment that I'm recording this. I have not figured out anything yet. That's eventually. So definitely go check that out. You can help out the show. I think that's everything I need to say. Oh, please follow us on Facebook, Instagram, Twitter, and on YouTube. We are on YouTube and have been now for a while when you're listening to this.
And please, please sign up for the Patreon, because we still need to raise money to see extended Snyder Cut Justice League. So
it's a good movie.
If you want to, I don't want to hear it. If you want to,
actually, it's a good movie. I'm not lying at all. I loved it, and I've seen it twice.
If you want me to talk about it, then by all means, please throw us a couple bucks for a month of HBO Now.
I should do that. One day I'll make that an actual, when I mess with Patreon, someday. When we finish the, at some point I'll mess with Patreon. All right. We will see you guys all next time. Bye, everybody.
Bye-bye. Bye.